praise you.
The one thing I love about having grown up in Kansas and then moving to South Carolina is I have gotten to experience two very different landscapes and cultures, and it's just very different here than it is in Kansas. And I love it because I've gotten to see God's creation in so many different ways. Like, I love being outside and backpacking and hiking and camping and all of those things, because it just gives me the opportunity to see God's creation. And in Kansas, you know, a lot of people say, like, oh, there's nothing good in Kansas, and it's just a flyover state. No, I drove through Kansas once, and it was the worst 17 hours of my life, but it really does feel like 17 hours when you're driving through it. But the reality is, you know, Kansas does have a beauty, and South Carolina has a beauty of its own. And I just love being out in nature and seeing God's creation for what it really is. And so if you've been with us for the past few weeks, you know that we've been going through the book of Job. You know that we started talking about all of Job's hardships and just losing everything. And it feels like a whirlwind. We've just kind of zoomed through this book because there's so many good things that we've had to skip over just for the sake of time. But, you know, we talked about Job's response to his pain. We've talked about Job's frenemies. Dylan referred to them as the Three Stooges. We talked about how Job was on top of the world and then got the worst surprise of his life. And then through all of this, over and over and over again, Job has just wished that he could speak with God. And he's said over and over again, oh, if only we were in a court. If only, you know, God can be put on the stand and I could talk to him and ask him why he's done all of these things to me. So he imagines this courtroom setting with him and God and a judge who's going to say, you know, what was right and what was wrong. And he just wishes over and over again that God would just show up. So how many of us have been in that place before? When we just are in a situation and we don't know how we're going to get out of it, and we've just been asking God to show up, and it doesn't feel like he's there. And I know I'm not just talking to myself this morning. I know that a lot of us in this room have been in that place at some point or another when it just doesn't feel like God is there. And so that's kind of where Job is at by the end of this book. So this is our last sermon in this series that we've called Life is Good. And so what we're going to find out, spoiler alert, we're going to find out that God was there all along. Every time that Job asked, where are you, God? God, why aren't you here? God, I just want to talk to you. God was there, and God was hearing everything that was being said. And he may not have chosen to speak up right away, but God was there. And so that's what we're going to look at this morning. As Job is just done with his friends, we kind of got to that point last week. You know, Job is just done hearing his friends' accusations, and finally, Job's wish is granted in Job chapter 38. So if you have your Bibles this morning and you want to follow along, we're going to be in 38 through basically the end of the book. So again, we're going to be skipping around a lot, but if you want to go ahead and turn to chapter 38, you can. And so finally, like I said, God shows up. And when he shows up, he has a lot to say because he's been hearing a lot of things. So this chapter is simply called The Lord Speaks, which is so fitting. And it says this in chapter 38, verse 1. Then the Lord spoke to Job out of the storm. And he said, who is it that obscures my plans with words without knowledge? Brace yourself like a man. I will question you, and you shall answer me. And so basically, what's going on here is God is getting ready to teach Job the biggest lesson of his life. And so we go on in verse 4. And God asked, "Where were you when I laid the earth's foundation? Tell me if you understand. Who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. Who stretched a measuring line across it? On what were its footings set? Or who laid its cornerstone? While the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy. Who shut up the sea behind doors when it burst forth from the womb? When I made the clouds its garment and I wrapped it in thick darkness? When I fixed limits for it and set its doors and bars in place? When I said, 'This far you may come and no further. Here is where your proud waves halt.'" He goes on, he says, "Have you ever given orders to the morning or shown the dawn its place, that it might take the earth by the edges and shake the wicked out of it?" And so basically what God is asking is, Job, who created this world? Who takes care of it every single day? Was it you? I mean, surely you know, he even says, who marked off the foundations? Surely you know, Job, right? Surely you were there when I created this world. And so surely you have the same amount of wisdom as me, right? But of course, we all know that the answer to that is no, of course not. Job wasn't there. Job is a mere mortal. He has no idea what it was like when God was creating the world, when he was telling the sea to back off the land and all of those things. Job had no idea. Job wasn't there. But what God is doing, and he goes on like this for the next four chapters, it's just God, he brings up different animals that he's created, and he says, you know, do you make the mountain goats give birth? Do you create the horse? And he even talks about these giant creatures that almost seem mythical that he's created, and he just says, you know, did you create these things? No. You can't even control them, but I can not only control them, but I created them. And so he goes on like this for four chapters. And basically, what God is doing is he's just reminding Job of everything that he's in charge of. And God is the God of all creation. And then in Job 39, I don't believe this will be on the screen, but in Job 39, God continues, and he brings up different animals. Like I said, he says, you know, do you know when the mountain goats gave birth? Do you watch when the doe bears her fawn? Do you count the months until they bear? Do you know what time they give birth? They crouch down and bring forth their young, and their labor pains are ended. Their young thrive and go strong in the wilds. They leave and do not return. Who is it that let the wild donkey go free? Who untied its ropes? I, God, gave it the wasteland as its home, the salt flats as its habitat. It laughs at the commotion in the town. It does not hear a driver's shout. It ranges the hills for its pleasure and searches for any green thing. And so God continues, and it's like he's almost doing a roll call of creation, where he brings up all of these animals that he's created, and he talks about how great they are and how wonderful they are, and all of the different abilities that he's given to each one. And basically, he's telling Job, look, I know when every mountain goat, when every deer is born, I know the tiniest details of what goes on in creation. Basically, what he's saying is that he is a big God. You know, humans, we think we've gotten so far because we have these computers that can, you know, send people to the moon, that can compute at crazy speeds. But the reality is we will never be able to create a computer that can contain as much information as even a fraction of everything that God sees every day. And the thing is, God is still involved in our world. That's the other thing he's telling us in these verses. And there's a growing belief today, I don't know if you've come across this, but a lot of people are starting to believe that, you know, maybe there is a bigger power out there somewhere that created the world. You know, they don't deny that we were created, but they say, but that God isn't still here. You know, that God left. He's no longer involved. That's a growing belief. But what these verses are saying is not only did God create the world, you know, however many years ago, but he's still actively involved today. He's still intimately involved today. And God is a God of both great power and small, tiny details. And when you look at creation, you see both. Now, I don't know if any of you have walked in our yard and in the churchyard ever in your life, but if you have, you've probably come across my worst enemy, which are fire ants. That's another difference between South Carolina and Kansas. When Dylan and I first started talking when I lived in Kansas, I made fun of him because he was afraid of ants, because I had never heard of fire ants. And I moved out here and I realized not only do fire ants exist, and not only are they the bane of my life, but I'm actually pretty allergic to them. So every time I get a bite, I swell up really bad. And so I had no idea that fire ants existed. I thought there was one type of ant, and that was carpenter ants, and they're harmless. You know, they may mess up your picnic, but they're no big deal. But I had no idea that there were different kinds of ants. And so as I was researching for this sermon, I was kind of thinking, like, what's the smallest animal I could think of? And I thought of ants, and so I looked into some research about them. Now, I just want to hear some guesses. How many different species of ants would you say there are in the world? Shout some out to me, someone.
How many?
I heard someone say a number. Someone just throw out some numbers. Come on.
100?
Okay. Higher than 100.
10,000?
Okay, actually not quite 10,000.
Yeah.
But okay, there are 8,800 discovered species of ants in the world. And that's just discovered. Like, you know, I'm sure there is some that we have not discovered yet. But over 8,000 different variations of a small insect with 3 body parts, 6 legs, and a class system. That's what it takes to be an ant. And there are over 8,000 variations of that. Now, what that tells me is that God cares about detail. Because how many of us could think of 8,000 different ways to create a small insect with 3 body parts, 6 legs, and a class system? Right? That seems pretty specific to me, but God found over 8,000 different ways to create that bug. And so God cares about detail. But not only does he care about the small things, but he also cares about the big things. Dylan, did those pictures get put in? Okay. So the picture that is going to be on the screen right now is a picture of a human next to Mount Everest. So you probably can't even see it in the back. But right here we have 3 humans stacked on top of each other. And then right here, that's the tallest building in the world. I don't remember the name of it. But then right next to that, the tallest man-made structure next to Mount Everest. Right? So Mount Everest is pretty big. But then when you zoom out a little bit, Dylan, you could go to the next one. That little tiny dot right there is Mount Everest, and you can barely even see it in the mountain range. Like, I wouldn't have been able to point it out unless it had been labeled for me. And so you think, okay, maybe Mount Everest isn't that big. But then when you zoom out again, well, this is North America, but you can't even see Mount Everest if you were to flip the world around. And so when you think about, like, man, our world is huge, right? Like, God is amazing to create something that big, that much bigger than us. But the reality is, Earth is small. If you zoom out again, here's a picture of Earth next to our sun. And so you think, man, you know, God is amazing, right? That he created the sun. That's such a big, incredible thing. But our sun isn't the biggest sun in the universe. In fact, our sun is actually pretty small. And here is a picture. Again, you probably can't even see it in the back, but that little tiny dot right there That's our sun compared to the biggest sun in the universe. It doesn't even fit on the screen. And so then when you go back to that picture of Mount Everest doesn't seem so big anymore, does it? It seems really small when you put it in perspective. And so not only is God a God of great detail, but he is a God of the big things too. He is a God of power. Because if we could have a picture of God and compare, you know, that sun to God, it'd be an even bigger comparison than our sun to the biggest star in the universe. But that is what God is reminding Job about in these final chapters. And it's almost as if God is saying he's laying out creation in front of Job. And it's as if he's saying, look, I'm in charge of all of this, right? I'm in charge of all of the stars in the universe, as big as they are. I'm in charge of all of the ants. I've got everything under control. So now that I'm here, and now that you get the chance to say all of these things that you claim you would say if the Creator showed up, what is it that you, Job, have to say to me? And now, Job is the wisest we've seen him. The book of Job is actually considered wisdom literature because there's wisdom to be found in it. And so in Job 42, Job finally responds to God. And you would think, you know, Job has been, this whole time, he's been saying, oh, if only I could talk to God, you know, this is what I would say, and I, you know, I have a list of all of the things I'm going to say to God, and all of the reasons I'm mad at him, and I just want to talk to him. And finally, after Job has seen the glory of the Lord, this is what he says, and I think it's the wisest thing Job or anyone has ever said, and it's in the beginning of chapter 42. Then Job replied to the Lord, I know now that you can do all things. No purpose of yours can be thwarted. You asked, who is this that obscures my plans of knowledge without knowledge? And surely I spoke of things I did not understand, things too wonderful for me to know. You said, listen now and I will speak. I will question you and you shall answer me. And now my ears had heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. And therefore I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes. And that's the wisest thing that Job could have said. He has completely forgotten all of the wisecracks, all of the questions he's had. And he just looks at the glory of the Lord and he says, you know what? I'm not worthy. You are God, and I see that now. And so Job has learned a very important lesson here, and it's the lesson for us today as well. And the lesson is this: when we see God for who he really is, nothing else matters. You remember that Job had been wanting to take God to court. And he's been asking from the beginning, from the very beginning, to see God face to face. But now that God is here, Job is speechless. He has nothing to say other than, I'm sorry, I repent. And last week we heard Job say that wisdom is choosing to keep God on the throne. But now that Job has seen who God really is, it's easy for Job to keep God on the throne because he sees that compared to God, compared to the greatness of God, nothing else matters. And so when we fully worship God, when we allow ourselves to rejoice in the majesty of who he is, of course, we'll let him be king of our lives, because why wouldn't we? And when we see God for who he really is, even our biggest problems seem foolish. But you see, our problem is, the reason it's so difficult for us to keep God on the throne is because we don't allow ourselves to fully worship God. You see, we like to keep God in this little box. in a little corner of our lives. And we come to church when it's convenient for us. You know, maybe we give 10% of our income, but it's not out of gratefulness, it's out of, I need to do this. Or maybe we give less, maybe we don't give at all because we want to make sure that our needs are taken care of first. And we distort the freedom that God has given us. And we say, this freedom allows me to do whatever I want because I know God's going to forgive me as long as I ask. And so we take God and we keep him in this little box that's safe and it feels good. And we worship him on Sundays, but we're not worshiping the true God. We're worshiping our little g God, our God in a box. And so that's not making God the king of our lives. And then if that happens, if we've been worshiping our God in a box, then something happens that makes us question our faith. You know, maybe not as serious as Job. Maybe we don't lose everything, but we lose something. We lose our job. We lose a loved one. We lose our health or something. And everything we know about God comes into doubt. And we find out that this little g God, this God that we've been worshiping, not only is he not the one true God, but this little God in a box that we've been worshiping can't do anything when problems come up. Because that is not the true God. And I want to say something about doubt before we get too much further. Because doubt is a huge part of my personal testimony. And I don't want to sound like I'm condemning doubt this morning. If you have ever, or if you are currently in a place where you're doubting something, please don't be ashamed by that. Don't feel like you need to hide it, like you need to put on a mask. Because, like I mentioned, doubt was a huge part of my testimony. And the only reason I'm a pastor today, the only reason I'm even a Christian today, is because I found people who I could ask questions. And they could, you know, they would admit that they don't always knew the answer, but they would look into it and they would help me wrestle with deep questions of doubt. And so I'm a Christian today, and I love God today because people helped me with my doubt. And so I don't want to sound like doubt is a bad thing, because doubt can lead to good things. But doubt by itself, when it goes unanswered, can eat away at us. And doubt comes when we realize that we've been worshiping a fake God, a God in a box. And so when we find someone that can tell us the truth, they're going to tell us that the true God is the creator and sustainer of life. And he's the God who keeps the seasons. He's the God who conquered death itself. And he's the God who gave us life. And he's the God who makes us uncomfortable. If you're always comfortable in your Christian walk, you're doing something wrong. Because God demands all of us. And I mean everything, even the part that you want to hold on to with everything that you are. God demands that too. And so we'll never understand God, and we'll never deserve him. And when we accept this, when we accept who God is, all of a sudden our doubts don't matter anymore. It's like Job. Job was doubting and he was questioning and he had so many things to say to God, but when he finally saw God for who he is, nothing else mattered. And so the questions that plague us when we find out our God that we've been worshiping is too small, they pale in comparison to who he is. And so then when this happens, when we understand all of this, we begin to replace worry with worship. And then when we replace worry with worship, our entire perspective changes. We go through an entire paradigm shift. And you see, because before, when we keep God in a box, our problems seem huge. And so when we face our problems first, we get overwhelmed because we bring our little box to our problems and we say, look, box, fix this, fix it. And our problems are just huge, and our box is so small that the box can't do anything. But then we start to feel despair even. because all of a sudden everything that we know comes into doubt. And there's no way that our God in a box can handle our mountains. But when we take God out of the box, when we throw the box away and worship the true God, the creator of everything, suddenly our problems seem really small. And not because they go away. It's not that they shrink to the point where they're just gone and we don't have to worry about anything anymore. Nothing about our circumstance may change when we worship first, but our perspective changes. Because when we worship the true God, we're worshiping an eternal God. So we get a glimpse into eternity. And people often think that eternity simply means forever or never ending. And while that's true, eternity means so much more than that. Because eternity is completely outside of time. Time is a created thing. And so God lives outside of time. And he's so much bigger than time that there's simply no time in creation or in eternity. But God chooses to step into his creation. He stepped into time to rescue us out of it. And so when we keep in mind that God not only created the biggest universe, everything from, you know, the stars in the sky to the tiniest ant, our entire perspective changes because we know that God not only created, but he is still sustaining every day the life that he's given to each one of us. And the psalmist David said it best in Psalm 144, verses 3 and 4. He said it like this: Lord, what are human beings that you care for them? Mere mortals that you even think of them. They are like a breath. Their days are like a fleeting shadow. And so David is looking at his life and he's seeing all of the things that have happened and he's realizing that his entire life, the life that takes up chapters, books in our Bible, was simply a breath. That's it. I mean, the life of King David was just a breath in the wind. And so this thought, this idea that our lives are just a breath, that can either lead us to despair or to hope. Because we can either get so caught up in our insignificance, we can get so caught up in the idea that we live on this tiny planet, you know, that we're so small even compared to our planet, that we just forget that we matter. And then that, you know, forgetting that we matter, it can spiral down into questioning why we're here. And it can spiral further into thinking maybe we don't need to be here at all. And it can continue to spiral into despair. Or the idea that our lives are just a breath in the wind can lead us to hope. Because we can make the decision to make our lives count for eternity. And how do we do that? Simply by choosing to worship first. And then we realize that when we see God for who he is, nothing else matters. And when we think about eternity, when we think about it being a concept completely outside of time, we realize that we can't take anything with us. We can't take our jobs. We can't even take our family as much as we would love to. We can't take our bodies, our health, our riches. Nothing goes with us. And so when we look at eternity, we realize that God is really all that we have. But on the other hand, he's all that we will ever need. And so that brings us back to Job. Because now Job is in this place where he has seen the greatness of God. And he realizes that in the midst of all of his wisdom, all of the things that he spent, you know, 20 chapters of him speaking, saying, he realizes that really he knew nothing. And he realizes that now nothing else matters. None of the doubts he had, none of the loss that he experienced matters because he is face to face with the one true God. And so he repents. That's why he repents in sackcloth and ashes, is because he thought he knew something, but he realizes he didn't know anything. And so we get to the epilogue, you know, the end of the book, and we find out that Job gets his happily ever after. And God forgives Job and his friends for speaking against God. And they make a sacrifice, and everyone ends up happy, you know. God grants Job twice the amount of riches that he had before. He gives Job another 10 children, not to replace the ones that he lost, but simply to give him new life and new excitement in his life. And, you know, the Bible doesn't say this specifically, but I know that at this point, Job didn't care about those riches. He didn't care that he had 14,000 sheep or 6,000 camels or any of that. He didn't care because Job had seen the living God. And he realized that nothing can ever compare to him. And so that God, even though he had chosen to bless him again, God didn't have to. And Job still could have been the happiest man in the world. But God chose to because of his goodness and his grace and his mercy. Because God is a good God. He's powerful and he's good. But God doesn't always bless us, right? When we go through times of difficulty, we don't always know if there's going to be a happily ever after. We don't always know if God's going to bless us twice as much as he did before. But the thing about what loss does, what losing things does, is it changes our perspective. And so we get to a point, if we go through grieving in a healthy way, we get to a point where we realize that God is all I have, but God is all that I need. And so that is the ultimate blessing in the book of Job. And that's really what it boils down to, is when we see God for who he truly is, nothing else matters. And I know I've said that a lot this morning, but I just want to drill it into our heads, because that is the whole point of the book of Job. And I know that that may be kind of hard for us to hear, because I know that there are people in this room who are facing mountains right now. But I want you to just, if you're in that place, if you're facing something that seems too difficult, look at how big your God is. I'll pray.